Hey, what's up, YouTube? Thanks for clicking on my video. Thanks for checking me out. It's my first video on my channel, and taking this opportunity right now to kind of talk to you guys and kind of give you guys a little bit of an insight on building an M16A1 in 2021. Very recently, there's been a lot of parts kits that have kind of gone on the market. And it seems like everyone has gotten the M16A1 phase. I mean, who wouldn't? It's a cool rifle. It's a cool looking gun. You got that retro vibe from it. You know, Vietnam and stuff like that. Vietnam era and, you know, early 70s and 80s and stuff like that. It's a very cool gun. Very cool history behind it. And so a lot of you guys are probably interested in buying these parts kits and building it out yourself. And getting your own piece of history and stuff like that. And I'm just here just to give you guys my opinion on building this thing and what it was like. And seeing if you think it's worth it. You think it's worth your time, worth your money and stuff like that. Again, this is just a video with my opinion. It's not fact. And again, I'm coming from the perspective of February 2021. What it's like. I don't know what it's going to be like in a couple years and stuff like that. And I don't have a crystal ball or anything like that. So this is just something just to give you guys a little insight on how mine went and how yours could possibly go if you decide to build one out. Just a little bit about me, my background, just dude who likes guns. I have no real serious gun. I'm not a gunsmith or anything like that. I've only had a little bit of armorer's training from the military, the U.S. military. But other than that, like, I'm just a Joe Blow. I don't got any big sponsors or anything like that. I'm not here trying to show you guys products. I'm just giving you guys an honest opinion on something. And maybe it's helpful to you. Maybe it's not. Maybe, I don't know, you stop watching or whatever. But just going to give you guys my opinion. So let's check it out. All right, first things first, about any project you want to start, you got to do some back planning. So one of the biggest things that you want to do before you get into the whole building and stuff like that is thinking about one major question. Do you want to go clone correct? And as far as clones goes, I know you guys, some of you guys out there probably know about the cloning community. They are a cloning community. Now there's all these sticklers out there that want everything to be clone correct, period correct, or whatever, whatever. And do you want to go down that route, or do you want to go kind of like a clone inspired route and don't care so much about having period correct lowered receiver, period correct, you know, freaking forward assist and stuff like that, period correct port door and stuff, magazines, grips and all that, or even the big one, the barrel, which we'll get into later. You gotta think about that and think about which route you want to go, because whichever route you choose, it's gonna dictate, I think it's gonna dictate your experience and also gonna dictate how much money you're actually going to spend and stuff like that. For me, I kind of went with somewhat of a clone correct what approach to doing this build. I mean, as clone correct as I could go and as clone correct as I was willing to go. There's a couple pieces which I'll get into when I break down my rifle about why I went the way I went with certain parts and stuff like that, but that's one question you gotta think of. Next question that I think of is, what kind of A1 do you want to do? Do you want to do just a regular M16A1? Do you want to like do like a mix mash of parts and stuff like that? Do you want to do like an XM16? Like, you know, this receiver, do you want to do a 601? Do you want to do a 604? Stuff like that. Because deciding which model you want to do, the M16 will dictate how your experience is going to be. I mean, obviously, some of you, if like, you know, you want to go for more clone correct stuff and you're going for like a 601, those parts are really hard to come by. I've seen a couple 601 parts kits online and they were going for like $3,000 plus just for a parts kit. And if that's the route you want to go and you got the money to spend and stuff like that, I mean, go for it. More power to you. I bet it's a really cool rifle and stuff, but those kits are really rare and those kits don't come onto the market very often. And if you're, you know, start off thinking you're gonna go with like a 601 or like an early M16 and you start buying pieces and stuff like that, or you buy a parts kit and you're missing this piece and this piece, it could be that those pieces rarely go on the market and you're pretty much gonna be stuck with a parts kit in a box in your closet or in your gun safe or in your gun room for a long time and you won't be able to enjoy it. Whereas you, if you went for like something more basic like a XM16 or friggin' M16A1 and stuff like that. So that's one thing you gotta think of. Why also do you wanna build an A1? Do you wanna do it just cause it's cool? Do you wanna go with like, are you like a reenactor, a Vietnam reenactor, or like US military reenactor and are going for, you know, some photos and stuff like that? Or do you wanna like kinda do like sort of historical shooting where you're like, you know, trying to see how things were back then, how the weapon ran back then, and you know, pair it up with like, you know, some 1956 web gear and stuff and you know, kind of like experience a little bit of history and stuff like that. So you know, that's another thing you gotta do is you gotta decide is like, why do you really want to go with the A1 and why not just in regular 20 inch barreled flat top modern M16 or something like that. Given that this design is kind of dated and stuff, if you don't have any desire for, you know, preserving history or like, you know, or you're not into surplus weapons and stuff like that, you're just gonna take out your rifle to go hunting, or you're just gonna go, you know, put some rounds down range on a paper and like once a year and like never really touch it and stuff like that, or maybe you want like home defense or something like that, I don't think an A1 would probably be best for that role, but I mean, again, that's just my opinion. But then again, you know, you never know. I mean, it is what it is, and you know, it's your gun, so you can do what you want with that. But you gotta ask yourself, why do you want to go with an A1? You know, if it's cool and you like building it, and go for it. You know, I went for an A1 because I like history a lot. Love the history of the M16A1. Kind of like that period of history, anyways, like middle Cold War to late Cold War, where the M16A1 was involved in a lot of different conflicts, not only in Vietnam and stuff like that, but also conflicts like Central America and stuff. So the M16A1 embodies that for me, and I really wanted to, you know, feel that history, you know, feel how it was. So that's something to think about, you know. All right, so you planned, you did all that you wanted to do. You're ready, made your decision. Now you're ready to drop some money on some parts kits and stuff like that. Now, to me, there's two ways you can go with in acquiring a parts kit or acquiring parts. And kind of alluded to it just there, but you can either go to a website and buy a parts kit with like all the parts, most likely minus the barrel, or you can do what I did and just piece together the parts little by little. There's a couple pros and cons to that. To each side. Big thing about the parts kit, just buying the parts kit straight up, it's kind of like one and done. You know, you're going to a website or, you know, buying it from someone or from a gun shop, and you're paying for all the parts that you would more than likely need, and all you need to do is probably just buy a lower receiver or something, or buy like, you know, little pieces here and there, onesies and twosies. Some pros with that is that it's one and done, like you just got it right there and don't have to like go out and, you know, it's like instant gratification, you know what I mean? It's right there, you already got it. However, One con might be like the price up front. As of right now, I think I've seen a lot of these parts kits going for like $400, $500. Sometimes they have like deals where they're like, you're missing like one or two parts for like $350 and stuff like that. Or, you know, maybe you get on a forum and someone's throwing, has a whole parts kit right there and on their, you know, marketplace or whatever, and you can just buy it straight up like that. Or like you can find them on Arms List or Gun Broker or whatever. But usually what I've been seeing right now is like, you know, $400, $500 for a parts kit. And, you know, you're getting the whole thing minus the lower receiver and probably the barrel. That being said, if you find a parts kit with a barrel, more than likely you're going to be paying way above $500 and could be looking into four figures for a parts kit. So that's kind of leads me into my next point. And my next way of another way you can get all these pieces is kind of the route I went, is just piecing it together one by one, piece by piece. So kind of like to give you a background, what I started off with is I bought this stock right here, this A1 stock, from some guy off Instagram. He has a page called Individual Surplus. He's a pretty cool guy, has a lot of stuff on sale. I bought this stock and this pistol grip, and I threw it on this A2 lower receiver with, I think at the time I had a, actually at the time I did have a PSA flat top 20 inch kind of A4 going on, and I decided to put the A1 stock and the A1 pistol grip on because I thought it looked cool. It was kind of a funky looking rifle at the time, but yeah, that's one way you can go. So I bought those two pieces first, and then after that, I kind of was like going back and forth of what I wanted to do with the gun, if I wanted to keep it the way it is, if I wanted to go like a traditional A4, and then I kind of just like said screw it and bought this upper receiver and decided to go with the A1 route. So I got this upper receiver on AR15.com's equipment exchange. You can find some really good deals on there. I don't remember how much I bought it for, but it wasn't that expensive. And I got this, and it already came complete with the rear sight and the port door. You need a correct port door and a correct rear sight. And so I bought those, and then I pieced all the rest of the parts from there. The one big thing for me about why I decided to go that route was piecing it all together, was because one, I could buy pieces when I wanted to, how I wanted to, and what type of pieces I wanted to get and stuff like that. And I kind of originally in my planning, after I decided I wanted to go with M16A1, I wanted to go with as parts correct as I could. So like I got period correct stuff, minus a couple obvious things here, but I got like, you know, period correct, you know, this piece, all surplus and stuff like that. It took me a while to put it all together. Altogether, it took me like, you know, I think it took me like 6 months, 8 months to put together an entire parts kit and stuff like that. But I think I spent less than what I would have paid if I would have gotten a whole parts kit, especially when it came to the barrel. Like, I think altogether I spent in total maybe like I would probably put it under $600. And I think the most challenging and most expensive piece I got was the barrel. But that's just something to think about. Like, if you don't want to spend that much money right there on the spot, you can kind of like, you know, piece these things together and come up with, as long as you know what you're buying and stuff like that, and you got a pretty good idea of what's up, like, you're in pretty good shape, you know? So that's one thing to think about when it comes to putting together this M16A1. To be honest with you, I need to address the elephant in the room. And this is the big thing that's kind of ruining a lot of people's experiences and kind of setting a lot of people back. And one thing I think you really need to look into before you even get into the parts kit situation, and that is the barrel. So right now, like as of February 2021, for some reason the ATF like doesn't, it's been this like this way for a while, but the ATF doesn't allow importation of barrels because they think it's like a lower receiver, like machine gun part or whatever. It's like banned from importation. So all these parts kits that are coming in today are without the original barrel, which kind of is a pain in the ass because, again, if you wanted to go clone correct or you wanted to go as close as possible to an A1, the lightweight pencil barrel is the way you want to go. Every so often, I do see barrels come up like secondhand and stuff like that, which is how I got this barrel. This is a Colt M16A1 barrel. And I got it for like, I think it's like 200 something bucks, 250 bucks. I was really lucky and I still can't believe I got it for that price. I got it off of a forum and, you know, it took me a while. It took me a while for me to find this barrel. I think like 1, 2, 3 months of actually looking and stuff like that. And I would just so happen to log on to the forum at the right time, at the right moment, because I know for a fact that that barrel would have been gone before I would even get a chance to write, I'll take it, or whatever. But as of right now, with the whole pandemic situation and stuff like that, there's like a shortage of parts. And just any type of barrel, if you look for any type of barrel that isn't like, kind of like one of these bigger, you know, name barrels, like, you know, like a 14.5 mid-length or whatever, like, barrel, it's gonna be hard to come by. And there's a couple companies out there that'll have runs of these barrels. I know a lot of people say like Green Mountain is a pretty good company to get barrels. They make a lot of barrels for different companies and stuff, like for different you know, platforms and stuff like that. And they make a pencil length barrel and one 7 twist or 1 12 twist. I think they also have 1 14 twist too. So that's an option, but they've been sold out for like a long time, and I don't know when they're ever coming back into stock. Your other option is, again, finding a Colt original barrel, which is gonna be pretty hard. Or like I've seen even FN or like, you know, barrels, you know, lightweight barrels like that, or, you know, there's these other websites like Retro Rifles, which I heard really bad reviews about. I would not suggest them. A lot of people don't suggest them because they'll take your money and then they'll refund your money like 6 months later because they can't fulfill your order and stuff like that. Same thing with like there's this other place, something arms, fucking TSC Arms or whatever. I don't know. One of these other places. I don't think it was TSC. I think it was something else. But they'll like take your money and then they won't come back with it and stuff like that. So if you can't find a barrel, you won't be able to complete your rifle and you won't be able to shoot your rifle. That being said, a lot of people will end up going for like any M20-inch barrel. 1 7 twist and stuff like that or whatever. Which I guess if you wanted to go that route, I mean, you can go for it, but it just won't be a correct M16A1. You know, PSA has all those barrels and stuff, and so does you know, other companies like DPMS has those barrels and stuff like that. So I mean, if you want to go that route, it's another option. You know, that's just what you're left with. You know, I think Wind and Weaponry also has a barrel like this, a pencil barrel, you know. So it's just something to think about. And again, when you also get those barrels, you'll probably get them stripped. So if your parts kit will most likely come with a front sight post, and you're gonna have to like get it drilled, and you gotta send it to places like ADCO or other places, a gunsmith, to get your barrel drilled so your front sight post taper pins can go through and stuff like that. I don't know if you can notice, but when I got this barrel, secondhand, obviously, and the person sent me this front sight post, but the taper pins weren't in all the way. They were like kind of like halfway through, so I had to like kind of pop them out again and then you know, install the triangle and install all this and stuff like that, and then actually install the front sight pins But if you can see, I kind of messed up on that. The front sight pin didn't go through all the way. And this kind of happens when you have, I think it's one of two reasons. One, it could have been that this front sight, the barrel wasn't drilled with this front sight post, as in like this wasn't the original front sight post that came with the barrel. And the taper, the front sight post like didn't fit this one, so like the taper pins didn't fit correctly or exactly. Or it could just been my installation error when I was putting it in. I put this pin in first before I put this pin in, and I think the best way to do it is kind of to do one by one, little by little. So like you'll take a couple taps of the hammer onto this, then you'll take a couple taps of the hammer on the back one, and such and so forth until they're both settled in. But could have been my fault, but I mean, I ran it, shot it, shoots fine, cycles and all stuff like that. So I mean, works for me. So again, I think it just wasn't the right front sight post to the original barrel and stuff, so that is what it is. But yeah, that's the elephant in the room when it comes to M16A1s is barrel availability, and it's like that for a couple of the parts kits right now. AK is going through the same thing. FAL's is trying to go through that right now, especially with like the Israeli parts kits that came in and stuff like that. So that's one thing to really consider before you jump into the whole M16A1 game. So gotta think about. All right, so say you got all your parts together, say you got all your parts kits together, you got a barrel, and you got everything together. Now, it's time to build it. Building it is gonna come together like pretty much any other M16 that, or any other AR-15 that you put together. For the most part, it's gonna be pretty smooth, especially like these parts to me, like especially the older parts, they're designed to they're designed to last forever, you know, at least in my opinion. This is a military rifle made in the 60s, and it's freaking still rocking and rolling. I mean, you can see some pictures online and see that a lot of these parts are still in use. A lot of these weapons are still in use from like the Vietnam era and stuff like that. And with like little maintenance, you know, these things, this is a good design gun. You know, it's a well-designed gun, and it's rocking and rolling, you know. But yeah, so if this is your first AR-15 that you're putting together, and you have no prior experience gunsmithing, I mean, you could do it. There's a lot of videos online teaching how to do it and stuff like that. But I'd be pretty careful, especially because like it's an M16 and you have the historical value in there like that. Maybe you want to build one more before you build this one. Especially if you got like all period correct parts and stuff like that, you know, you might want to like, you know, take care of it and stuff. But hey, it's your rifle, it's your parts, you can do what you want, learn as you go. But yeah, it should go together pretty good. I mean, you can also send it to like a gunsmith to put together, a main local gunsmith, or like there's a couple people online that a lot of the forums that people like to send their rifles to and stuff. But you know, it is what it is. You know, it's an AR-15. You know, you can, you know, they go together like Legos. It's not like you're putting together like a AK or something. All right, now I'll just go over my A1. So yeah, I got, like I said, I pieced together this A1 from a lot of different places. I bought some stuff on like the AR-15 equipment exchange, bought some stuff off people on Instagram, got some stuff in the local surplus stores and stuff like that. I got this sling from eBay. One of those like seatbelt, they call them like a seatbelt nylon slings. It's pretty cool, pretty awesome. So yeah, like I said before in the video, I wanted to go over like a period correct video, and like this entire rifle, all the parts on here are mostly Colt parts. Shout out to Shark Arms. Shark Arms has a good selection of like M16A1 parts, all those little small parts, like, you know, the magazine release and like the forward assist, or like all these little pins and stuff like that. And he's great to deal with. I bought a lot of stuff from him, and he helped me in this build, helped me supply all the stuff for this build. And he has some great prices and good shipping. I can't suggest him enough. He has like a lot of stuff. At one point he did have A1 barrels. I don't know if they're ever gonna come back in the stock, but who knows, you know. But yeah, this is my M16A1. I guess from tip to butt. We'll go from butt to tip, or whatever fucking Grantham says. But yeah, I got this A1 stock from some guy on Instagram, Individual Surplus. He had some good stuff. I liked it a lot because it has like this weird like kind of rainbow thing. I don't know if you can see it on camera, but it's like this weird like kind of like trench art rainbow thing going on, which is pretty cool. Who knows whoever put that on there. It has this like rack number on there, which is pretty cool, which I like a lot. I kind of like that look of like used and abused and like weathered and stuff like that. This gun is like so light compared to like the PSA 20-inch barreled AR that I had, and like even like compared to like a M4, like I was in the army, like M6, like a M4 carbine, like this is like comparable to that. I haven't put it on the scale. I bet you can Google it and see how much an actual M16 weighs. But did that pistol grip, same thing, original. The lower receiver, I went with like an XM16 lower receiver from Brownells. You can see Brownells. I bought a Blem. It was only like $125. They get their forges from Nodak Spud, but I think they machine out the forges from for like Arrow Precision does it or something like that. I forgot where I read it from, but I got this as a Blem, and I think the only Blem is the anodizing. It's kind of like purplish anodizing. I think they were trying to do like gray or whatever, and it just came out kind of wrong, but I don't care. Hopefully it like wears in pretty good and weathers in pretty good and looks better, as there's like a real big difference between the top, which is a, you can see, Colt Harvey forge. It's like Colt gray compared to this purple or whatever. But yeah, do that. Magazine. Funny story about these 20 round magazines and all my magazines, all my 20 rounders, is I was in the army. I was an armorer in one of my units, and just sitting in the arms room was like a big old box of 20 round magazines that first sergeant was like, hey, get it out of here and stuff like that. And somehow these 20 round magazines came home with me. I don't know how they just found their way, sprouted legs, and just hopped in with me and stuff. So but now they're here. Yeah. I'm gonna open this guy up, show you guys the bolt carrier. This is one thing I wanted to show you guys. C-mark bolt carrier. As you can see, it's a Colt. However, yeah, it's a Half Moon bolt carrier. So it's technically an SP1 bolt carrier. Maybe one day I'll go in and grab a full auto bolt carrier, but this works for me now, so can't complain. Hands are all oily from the bolt carrying stuff. I went shooting the other day, took this guy out, and this guy shoots great. cool thing is, the original slip ring I got in like some parts lot. Some guy was selling off of like some form. I got it, but the But the original part, like when I went to go install it, it was like too loose, and I looked at it and it had a straight crack through. So I had to, like, after I installed the barrel and stuff, like, I had to take off the barrel and replace this. If you go online on eBay and look for this flat delta ring, there's a guy who's selling like bagged NSN sealed flat rings for a pretty cheap price, like $3.99 or something like that. And I was like, oh, well, it's pretty cool. You know, it's an NSN marked and all that stuff like that bag. I mean, it could be fake, but it seemed pretty legit to me. But also what he did is he also threw in a free, like the original pistol grip screws. Like, I don't know if you can see it in there. Like those silver, or not silver, but like chrome pistol grip screws that are actual like flathead screwdriver ones, which are like period correct for like early M16s instead of like Allen wrenches, Allen wrench heads that the other M16A2s and M4s now have. So got this handguard set from, I don't even know where. I think I got this at the surplus store, but it's in pretty good condition for what it is. A lot of the times when you're buying M16A1 handguards, they might have the teeth crack up here. This one came in pretty good shape. I think it's original. Pretty sure it's original, but you never know. It's kind of like, I don't think there is ways to look if it's original online, but this doesn't look repro, and there's like a bunch of like use on it and stuff like that, so I'm pretty sure it's not repro. There's that. One funny thing about the gas tube here is the gas tube that I got with a parts lot, it was like bent really bad. And when I went to go install it into the barrel and the receiver, it did not fit. It was like bent to one side. So I actually went on to Apex Gun Parts and got a second, like a new old stock gas tube, which works perfectly fine. Shout out to Apex too. They do have a lot of M16A1 parts. I think they've been getting a lot of stuff from who knows where. I think like same Southeast Asia, the Southeast Asia lots that came in. But yeah, it works fine. My rifle cycle's fine now. Everything's good. All good in the hood. Yeah. I mentioned the front sight post situation with the barrel. And I got this A1, typical A1 flash hider with the crush washer. So, you can see that. But yeah, she shoots pretty good. Like I said pretty recently, even with the ammo scare, I was able to find some of this stuff. Some of this stuff, 223, Remington 55 grain. That being said, I'll mention the 55 grain. This is a 1-in-12 twist barrel, so the 55 grain will stabilize better in the 1-in-12 twists compared to like a 62 or like a 74 or 76 or whatever grain. Those heavier bullets kind of don't stabilize out of a 1-in-12 twist. But yeah, I was shooting good with this Remington stuff. I zeroed my M16A1 using the traditional good old US military zeroing target, and started off pretty low, creeped my way up, and ended up shooting up in here and figured it was zeroed, so hit steel at 100 yards and like dead on. So I really like the sights for this rifle. The skinny blade for the front sight post is like pretty awesome compared to like that fat blade. And then these A1 sights are pretty simple to use. That's the one thing a lot of people say about the M16A2 is that they're like target sights or like match sights and stuff like that, or match inspired sights. And that was mostly done because of the Marines wanted it that way and stuff. But they're kind of complicated. Not really complicated, but it's kind of like a lot going on back there. And I can see how this A1 style sighting is like way more simpler, and like especially for like, if you think about it historical wise, like the army back then was a draft army, so maybe not the most educated and stuff like that. I mean, not to say that the volunteer army now is like geniuses or Harvard grads, but you know, easier to use, especially also too, like we're giving these out like crazy to like all these countries for aid and stuff like that. All these went down to Central America and stuff like that. And I can see how these sights might have been more simpler to use, you know, for them, you know, peasant armies or whatever. But yeah, so like I said, it's mostly all cool parts minus the trigger. The trigger I have in here is some cheapo trigger, like I think it's like a polished Anderson trigger. It was like only trigger I had, and the reason why I went with that is because usually the triggers are like the full auto triggers, so you have to do like some adjustment to those in order for them to fit in your triggers, your lower receivers and stuff like that. I probably end up getting a Colt trigger one of these days. Just been lazy and just putting it off, other project going on and stuff like that. But yeah, it works for me. I did have one issue with this trigger, was I was getting that dead trigger thing where like it wouldn't reset after a couple shots. I ended up having to file down like the disconnector a little bit. There's some couple burrs in there. That's what I get for getting some cheap, shitty ass Poverty Pony trigger. But hey, I'll deal with that later. I filed it, fired it, it's working now, so is what it is. But yeah, just wanted to give you guys my opinion on the thing, whether or not it might be worth it for you guys to do an M16A1. I mean, there's a lot of stuff about options out there and stuff, and it's up to you guys whether or not you want to do it. In my opinion, if you like history and you, or you doing the reenacting and stuff like that, and you want to shoot as well, like shooting as well, I think it's awesome. The only thing is the barrel. I have this feeling that there's like a warehouse somewhere out there in the country or somewhere overseas with a bunch of these barrels just waiting to get surplus that no one has found yet. And I'm holding out for that because I wouldn't mind doing another M16A1 build. It's so much fun to shoot. It's so cool just to like have that piece of history and see like where all the M4s and stuff like came from, and you know, it was just a fun project for me, and I love shooting this rifle. Pretty accurate. So that's my video, guys. Just wanted to give you guys a little insight. Hopefully it's helpful for you. If not, like comment down below, tell me why you think it's not worth it or whatever. Comment down below with your opinions. Say what's up. Hit me up. And, yeah, man. That's...